Hello and welcome to a rather dreary countryside here in the west of France, in Brittany, in the beautiful little town of Plouay, a hotbed of world cycling, and this week has been the venue for all of the World Cycling Road Championships, right through from juniors to the elite. It's the elite we are going to look at today, bringing together a rather small field of 158 riders representing 30 nations. They cover a course of 14 plus kilometres and they'll cover that course 19 times.
This course field, many of these riders know it because it's based on the same course as the Grand Prix of Plouay, the race in the west of France, which was won this year by Michele Bartoli. But the French will all be cheering for their own country today. There's Richard Virenque on the start line, and it will be certainly a great festival of cycling.
Doesn't show any signs of the worry he must be feeling, because he's in court very shortly in Lille when the Festina affair will reach its climax. There is the president of the World Cycling Body, the UCI, waiting for the OK from the timekeeper, Hein Verbruggen, and he's about to fire the gun, and away they go, 158 riders. The field has never been as big as it was pre the holding of these World Championships towards the end of August, first week of September, and even today there are big names missing, like Jan Ullrich, the Olympic champion, is not here. Neither is Alex Zula, they're only two. And of course Lance Armstrong, but he has always said he wouldn't come.
He's always been very much against the World Championships in the latter part of the season. And it really does restrict, Phil, the number of places in the world where they can hold the World Championships, because in the northern part of Europe, as we go towards the end of October, we really will face wintry conditions.
Hardly seems a year ago in Verona when Oscar Freire, the Spanish rider who started on the front of the bunch there, became the world champion. It was a surprise, but since then he's notched 9 wins, so he's a well-known rider in the peloton now. On that occasion he beat Marcus de Berg and Jean-Cyril Robin of France. The field then will by tradition start slowly and build up, and the survivors, well, they'll fight out the race for the rainbow jersey.
On a course like this, I would expect this race to get blown to pieces towards the end, because this is a very difficult course. Although only 14 kilometres around, it really is the repetitive nature of these slopes on the climbs here at Plouay which will blow the race to pieces. And as always, we can expect the big rivalries to come between France and Italy.
Just listen to the crowd here. This is a wonderful area. They're cycling mad. It's a fabulous place to have a World Championships. But how much nicer would it be in warm sunshine? Because everybody here today has got their Wellington boots on and their overcoats, while the riders themselves have got foot warmers, as you can see, long sleeves, and some of them starting, as the rider on the left there, in long-fingered gloves as well.
Well, the Spaniards will be really be looking to be a dominant team in the early part of this event, because although Oscar Ferreira's win was somewhat of a surprise, he's come up with the goods this year and confirmed that he is a top professional cyclist, and I would think, Phil, we will see him being a major challenger again.
The Breton flag waving proudly. This is their course, and many of the people here are coming to watch all of the top cyclists fight out the world title here. They come every year to watch the top riders ride in the Grand Prix Plouay and enjoy the spectacle, but I suggest in warmer conditions. But even so, the best bike riders now before them as they head out towards the big circuit. Now, these pictures were taken at the start earlier today. We're now going to pick up the action. A breakaway of 9 has got away at 60 kilometres on the fourth circuit. The Polish team are chasing. We are approaching 10 laps to go. So this is the Polish team who have driven this race, Paul, for a number of laps. I'm not too sure of their tactics, because they must have great confidence in one member of the squad to drive it like this, and the other riders behind are quite happy to allow it.
It's a long time since we've seen a Polish squad at the World Championships quite so dedicated as this to do all of the work on the front of the main field. These guys have been in the saddle now for over 3 hours of bike racing, and I tell you one thing, the speed that it's been run off at so far, it's going to cause some pretty serious breaks in the main field in the last 2 hours.
Well, there's the gap as the clock will stop as they go through. They drive on, the counter on the right, 10 laps still to go on this course. This is very typical of elite racing, allowing a breakaway to run and then start to drive it down. And the big bunch quite happy at the moment, and that you see is the danger here. This feeding station is in a rather bad and precarious place, slightly downhill. The riders come to here pretty quickly, and you know, during the races this week they've had one or two problems, and they're having it with the pros today.
This is always a dangerous point because the helpers come further and further into the road, actually causing a natural alleyway, and that's why they do get these accidents.
There's an old ordinary or penny farthing, and I'll tell you what, they're really difficult to ride. I defy many of the professionals today to climb on the back of that. You need a lamppost first of all, and then you approach it from the back while it's totally unaware. And once you're up there, goodness knows how you get off.
Huge organisational job has been done here by the organising body here at Plouay for the culmination really of their week festival of cycling, and this is the World Professional Road Racing Championships. They call it the Elite Championships nowadays, but this is really the ultimate. These are the best men in the world, and this is part of the course field which is very difficult indeed. The thing about the course here around Plouay is there's nowhere to rest and recuperate. It's hard on all of the time.
Chance now to look at these nine men. They got away on the fourth lap when they set the fastest lap time so far, 18 minutes and 9 seconds, an average speed of nearly 47 kilometres an hour. That's when Beneteau, Jimenez, Lelekin, Diaz Justo, Bosha, Pronk, Morrow, Marichal, De Luca all got clear of the field. And now here we are on lap 10, and the time for the last lap was just over 19 minutes, so that was a very quick lap.
Very rapid lap indeed. But the strange thing I've always found about the professional road race, Phil, is it starts fairly slowly and it builds up in magnitude towards the end. And very often, if you look back through the records, you'll find that the fastest lap at a World Championships has usually been the last one.
And despite the conditions here, the crowd all the way around the circuit, just take a look at the mud on the side of the road. People who have been camping here have been paddling the way to the fence, I think. But even so, they've stayed and stuck to the guns and enjoyed some excellent World Championship racing here. As we look down now at Christophe Moreau of France. So the French have got a man in the move. Give them an easier ride for later perhaps, because their big name still waiting to fire at the rear of the field. This is Roger Beauchat, the Swiss rider. He also has got his big team behind him.
It's a pretty dangerous rider in here as well, just sitting on the back there for Italy. Danilo De Luca, a big favourite, a man who we saw ride very well at the Giro d'Italia earlier this season, which is why I think the Italians are not chasing at all at the front of the main field. They feel quite happy having De Luca in this group. The rider from Belgium who's managed to slip in there as well, Thierry Marichal, a French-speaking rider, he too is just sitting back, not contributing too much. I think most of Belgium today, Phil, will put their hopes on the shoulders of Axel Merckx.
Well, it's unlikely the breakaway will hold them off to the finish, but there's only the Poles chasing, maybe because of the spread of the nations here. De Luca is, as Paul has said, probably the biggest name to be here. He was trying so hard to pull on the Maglia Rosa of the Giro d'Italia this year. He got himself up in the end for a stage win, and he got up the second overall, but he never quite got the jersey before he gave it all up. But he's had 6 wins now this season and a real up-and-coming star of the future. There he is. He's only just over 24 years of age. He's one of those cocky riders who knows what his talent is and is prepared to show it to the world.
Certainly is a great bike rider. He was hoping to ride well at the Olympic road race as well, but he was put into a second position really, looking after his teammates Michele Bartoli and Paolo Bettini. They were the ones in the action, but you can see the crowd is absolutely magnificent, and there's a lot of pressure still being put on the front of that main field, Phil, by the Polish squad. And I can only really think of one name, and that must be Zevgeny Spruch, a man who has been very consistent so far this year in the one-day races, and they may well feel that today is the day that he can bring themselves a World Championships. It actually takes me back to probably, I would say, the 70s, looking at the strong Polish amateur team that used to dominate the races. Riders like Rzysiaw Sukowski, who were absolutely magnificent, and it's really not since then that we've seen a dominant Polish team at a World Championships.
Absolutely right, but the days of the old Iron Curtain is gone now, thank heavens. And these riders are now free to be professional cyclists as well. as they set the pace. This is a Danish rider on the front here, by the way. These are the poles, slightly different colour pattern. And I think Paul is right. There's only one name that we would contemplate being a world champion by the end of the day, and that be Zbigniew Spruch. He rides 110, and significant enough, he's not in this pacemaking group here, so he has made them chase it down. And very typically professional riding, they're allowing the poles, they know they've got a plan, of course, but they're allowing them to bring back this breakaway if they can. It is coming down. Whether it's coming down quick enough, it's 4 minutes 18, the last time check we got.
It almost certainly will come down because these guys are making a concerted effort on the front. This is the very technical part of the course. Having come through the start-finish line, you then head out on the large circuit, 14 kilometres around. And this part of the course, if you're sitting near the back of the main field, it is very difficult indeed because there's always the acceleration and deceleration into these corners. And that's why, even at a World Championships level, it's so much easier to ride in the first 20-25 places.
Well, in the Espoirs race on that bend, we've just seen them come round. The heart was in the mouth of some of the riders because they completely misjudged it. Back up with the leaders now as they head under that start-finish banner again. Massive crowd cheering them on, clapping to keep warm as much as anything else as they continue to set the pace. This is Eladio Jimenez sitting at the back as we've gone back to the main field. The Kazakhstan riders are in that sort of turquoise colour with the yellow flower on it. And we'll get a time check as the riders come through. But still the poles are not being interfered with here, enjoying their pacemaking. I think that's the word.
You can see how difficult it is at the back of the main field there. Those guys are really hammering to try and stay in contact with the wheel in front of them. But it is a pretty good combination at the front of the race at the moment, with Eladio Jimenez of Spain getting in there. A major revelation in this year's Tour of Spain. A man that I'm sure there will be a lot of fights about during the winter months, because certain teams, although he still has a current contract with the Banesto squad, certain teams are already making noises that they would like to bring him across to strengthen their squads for the coming season.
Well, it was 4:18, they're now saying 4:19 as we go out onto lap number 11. The voice there of the man who calls the Tour de France, Daniel Mangias. Terrific knowledge of the sport, and he knows every rider without referring to a note. A magnificent commentator. Thank heavens he doesn't work in television.
He's unbelievable. He can talk for hours and hours about cycling. He knows absolutely everything about these guys, and he basically earns a living covering all of the major cycling events in France throughout the year.
Well, there's a lovely picture. This really is a fabulous part of France, out on the west coast, not very far away in fact from the home of Bernard Hinault, five-time winner of the Tour de France. Hinault is here, of course, and that's very typical Breton housing, with the grey slated roofs and the white painted, those steeply spired churches. And I can guarantee the bars will be absolutely buzzing as the race continues. A bit of pacemaking being done by Piotr Szymielewski. He's the Polish man at the front, his teammate here gritting his teeth. I think it's Piatek. They're all up here now. The man who's missing is Spruch. And Jalabert is there too, look.
Jalabert sitting pretty close to the front of the pack. Sprukfil will sit in the main pack, probably around about 25th place at the moment. He will have a lot of responsibility put onto his shoulders there by the rest of the team, because the fact that they're chasing like this, they really are transferring responsibility to him to finish off the work that they're doing. Jalabert looking very calm and collected at the moment. He's got a world championship title under his belt, that of the individual time trial, and he would certainly love to try and get himself a victory here in France. There next to him is Paolo Bettini with the green shoulders there of the Italian squad. Bettini's had a magnificent season so far. Davide Rebellin, the other rider in the green there, also a little further back. Italy, I think, for the moment, pretty happy having Danilo De Luca in that leading group of riders.
Been a difficult selection process for the Italians because the sport is so popular in Italy, of course. Everybody, including the selectors, say what they feel about selection, and the public split over the decision to leave out David Rebellin and instead put in Marco Pantani. Well, he's one of the Ukrainians who's called it a day. Now, Gonchar was the top rider here. This isn't Sergei Gonchar. He's already won the World Time Trial Championship this year. And this is the sort of conditions. It's Vladimir Duma, who was the last rider, and I think the only rider, to finish for his team in the Tour of Italy, wasn't he, Paul?
He was, in fact, and he took out a stage victory, a win at the front of the main field, I should say, just behind the great breakaway by David McKenzie, Australian rider on the Linda McCartney squad. He popped out of the pack there, and nobody really knew who he was at the time, and now he's taken an early shower. Still, the poles on the front, Phil, they really are digging deep, and they're going to have to do something pretty special. They've taken 40 seconds off the advantage of those leaders right now, and still, it's a very large pack for a World Championships at this stage.
Under the banner again, the gap is coming down, but ever so slowly. The clock counts on, but it was inside. Well, they're saying 4:01, but I think it's less than that, because the head of that field went under that banner. As another lap is ticked off by the driving of the Polish boys, there's no doubt they've got a plan, and the rest of the race is thanking them very much for taking them all up to the leading group, and they're offering no assistance at all. So every one of these Poles sacrificing his world title for one man. We think we've nailed down the man in Zbigniewsbruck, because we can't see him, and he must have told his teammates to go and drive the race.
Well, he must feel good. He's had a very good season with a lot of placings in the individual single-day World Cup races. He's a magnificent bike rider. I'm not sure that I would rank him as a world title shot, but maybe today he's in a special day, which is why he's asked his team to come forward. And the thing is, they have really missed the boat, the Poles here, because even the French must be pretty happy with having Christophe Moreau in that leading group of riders. All the major nations at the World Championships, the French, the Dutch and the Belgians, have got representatives up there, and of course the Italians too, which is why this situation has developed on the road for Poland. They're going to have to chase, and a 4.5 minute gap is a very difficult one to have to pull back at this stage of the race, because we're only just past half distance, and there won't be too many Poles left with good legs towards the end with a chase like this inside them.
Well, I think as you spoke there, Paul, there's one just blown out and he's dropped away from the front. He said, that's my lot. And I think it was Szymieski. He's gone to the back now as the rest continue. Well, although our screen a few minutes ago did say 4 minutes, we're getting checks now of 3:30, so this chase is working. It's bringing it down to very manageable performance. 19.5 minutes, very consistent laps. Remember when the break went, the pace shot up. They went through in just over 18 minutes, but they've regulated now at around 19.5, 19:40 for the 14.1 kilometre lap.
Just looking at the long line of bike riders there, you can feel the pain and the speed of this main field. But you know, it must be that they are working for Spruck this year, because Spruck has had a magnificent season in the one-day classics. Finished fourth in Milan-San Remo back in March, followed that up with a ninth place in the Tour of Flanders, eighth in the Amstel Gold Race. So he's always been looking to put in a good performance, and in fact we did see quite a lot of him at the front of the main pack in the Olympic Games, which wasn't too long ago in Sydney, but certainly under slightly different climatic conditions.
Well, I've known Zbigniewsbruck for a long time, because I used to organise the British Milk Race for many years, the race director of that for 21 years, and in fact Zbigniew was one of the stars of the milk race. He used to come and ride. But look at this, Paul, an attack now by the French. Oh no, this is coming back through the cars, so we've had a flat tire.
It's a problem. That's Jalabert who is down there. He's being paced back into the main field, and it may well be that he's had a flat tire. There doesn't seem to be any panic at all there. He's being paced back into the race by one of his teammates, and there's a Dutchman just sitting on the back there for the ride.
Well, if you've got to puncture, early is better than later. Jalabert, though, returning to the fold in many ways here to represent his country, because he had a bit of a fallout over the last couple of years on the anti-doping policy and the exterior testing of riders, and the fact that he's moved to live in Switzerland away from the French, rides for a Spanish team, etc. Lost a lot of favour amongst the officials, but they've let him back in now, and he would love a result, because at the end of the year he apparently is going to leave Anse, and then he'll be looking to come in to a French team.
He also has a problem that he doesn't have a contract signed at the moment. He actually declared that he wanted to have his contract signed and sealed before he went along to the Olympic Games. Well, that didn't happen at all. And in fact, now he's still getting towards the end of the season without a contract for the coming year.
Big Tom Leeper, I think it is. We caught a glimpse of Australia there. Just move up on the outside. It's only four Australians started today. Jay Sweet, the sprinter. Scott Sunderland, who was rather miffed, he was not selected for the Australian team for the Olympic Games. He appealed that decision but lost, and he's got good form at the moment. Stuart O'Grady is in here, fresh after his crash, well not fresh, but since his crash in the Tour de France. He rode in the Olympic Games but not with any real distinction, and Tom Leeper we've just seen.
It's Francesco Casagrande just on the left with the green. Laurent Brochard in the middle. Brochard riding very well this year, almost got himself a stage victory at the Vuelta a España not too long ago, coming into the city of Avila just towards the end. There's Scott Sunderland there in the Australian jersey with the glasses on.
Scott is just the man, Paul, to throw a surprise at us today, because he's very annoyed about his non-selection for Australia, especially in his own country. The Olympic Games were in the state of New South Wales. He's a New South Welshman. He comes from Inverell, so he desperately wanted to ride those games, but didn't make it. And he's up here at the head of the race. One gets the feeling now that the Polish team are tiring, but they are still closing in on those leaders, which are beginning to show signs of raggedness. We're not seeing too many pictures of them, but when we do see them, there are signs of riders getting a little bit tired now. New Italian team colours off to the right with the green tops of the jersey.
This is Piotr Wadecki on the front, one of the riders of the Moroz team. The only fully fledged international team from Poland, a very well-drilled squad. They take part in many races all over the international circuit. And just now they are riding an excellent race. The Polish team have really got themselves organized today, but they should have had a man in that breakaway because every other major nation was represented. The tactics at the World Championships are always very strange indeed, because it's always a big battle between France and Italy, and everybody else very often just seems to be along for the ride.
Just got a glimpse there of number one, Oscar Freire, last year's winner, riding near the head too, but not overdoing it. He's a marked man, of course, now, 1 year on, 9 wins, and a real challenger, recognised by the pelotons, a man for the future. Had this back problem all year, which he hopes to get sorted out as he runs out of his season now. Still, of course, a rather exciting and very interesting Tour of Lombardy to come, with André Schmill now showing a challenge to Eric Zabel for that championship. And Schmill starting today, one of the favourites. Another non-starter today, by the way, Abraham Olano. He's gone back home to Spain.
Well, he was a little bit surprised at not taking out the win in the individual time trial. He was the number one favourite, fresh from the Olympic Games. He felt as if he would have won the event, and he blamed it on bad communication between himself and his manager. But I have always thought that if you go out to win a time trial, you have to ride as hard as you can for as long as you can. So I think maybe the form just wasn't there.
And of course, no Andrea Taffi on the Italian squad, and there's no one more disappointed than he after winning the Paris Tours in such fine style. And when you look down the list of riders who have made the Italian squad, you really do have to ask the question, why leave out Andrea Taffi?
Well, Taffi, whether or not he's won a lot of races this year, is always a man to be counted on for the team. He's always the kind of rider who will work beautifully as a domestique, and surprisingly enough, they have left him out. And he'll probably be watching this at home now, not very happy, thinking, if I'd have been there, I'd have been ripping this race to pieces right now.
Back up with the leaders. That's Jimenez at the back of the race. Well, he was. He's not at the back of the race now. That's Marichal, who's come to the back. There's two Spanish riders in this group, enough to keep a worry over the field behind, although neither would be expected to be world champion by the end of the day. As Gert Kronk of the Rabobank squad sets the pace here at the front. This is Tilly Marichal.
Russian rider in there is Lelekin. He's a fairly young, 27 years of age. These riders now, Phil, really are realizing that the chase is on behind, as Marichal leads them up to the end of the lap. In second place, that is Pronk. Christophe Moreau must be feeling quite happy about this race situation, and looking at Danilo De Luca there in the Italian jersey, he doesn't actually seem to be flying all of that well at the moment. He's actually having a hard time staying on the wheel of the man in front of him, so we may well see another change in tactics later on. If the Italians get wind that in fact their man Danilo De Luca is not riding too well, I think they will come to the front as well and start to chase.
Well, I think this is attack time here. They've decided these nine riders are getting a little bit cumbersome. They know that the Polish train is reducing it, and they're trying to split the field here as they come up this very nasty drag. It'll get worse too as the race goes on, because that is Roger Bosciak who has got on the train, and Gert Kronk is tagged on, but there's a few missing now.
That really has split the field. Marichal really put the hammer down, and that has reduced the number of riders, and I think that is not going to be a great move for them, because we've now seen the two Spanish riders there being left behind. The other French rider who was in that break earlier on, Beneteau, he has now been slumped to the rear as Christophe Moreau decides to come forward now and accelerate on the slopes of this climb. All of the French riders must be on a serious high here today because they are racing on a circuit which in the month of August sees around about 250,000 spectators witnessing the Grand Prix of Plouay. Five riders now leading the race, but behind, the riders from Poland really are doing an excellent job, and they're slowly but surely eating into the advantage of this breakaway.
Well, this is a surprise. Thierry Maréchal trying to split the field. He's not a rider of great note. I'm just wondering what his tactic is. A couple of tours under his belt. He's ridden the last two editions and finished both of them rather lowly, but nonetheless, to finish the Tour de France is a tremendous achievement.
Well, the two Spaniards have been caught here. One is Eladio Jimenez and the other is Rafael Diaz Justo. And the other rider caught out in that split was the Russian rider Sergei Lelikin. If they can integrate over the top of this climb, they will reform to make a nine-man leading group. But looking back, it looks as if they've already lost around about 20 seconds from the five riders who are leading right now.
168 kilometres done. Five of the original nine that got clear around the 60-kilometre point. So they've been 100 kilometres together. The two Spanish riders are being dispatched backwards, as too is Walter Benito, the Frenchman, and the Russian rider Lelikin. Maréchal was the troublemaker, 27-year-old. He's got two wins this year, including finishing second overall in the Circuit Franco-Belge. A very good result for him, so he's got his form at the right time.
Christophe Moreau has decided what his tactic is going to be as we get confirmation of the group there. Although I did say that Danilo De Luca looked under pressure, he's still in this leading group of five, and so that will take the pressure off the Italian squad behind. Walter Beneteau, by the way, in the second group on the road there for France, won the Circuit de Lourdes, which is not too far away from here. It used to be known as the Critérium of Châteaulin, and it was always the great big revenge match after the World Championships, when the World Championships were held in August. So that was a big win for him, and he too is a rider from not very far away from here, from Nantes, and was a member of Jean-René Bernadot's Vendée U development squad.
Slipping to the back now, 101. Mate Pronk, I think I called him Gert Pronk earlier. Gert, who was an ex-speed skater, that's having too many memories, I think. Gert is now out of it, but this is Mate Pronk, who's up in the breakaway. Sits at the back, and it's a good move by the youngster as well.
Christophe Moreau is the strongest rider in the group right now, and it'd be nice to go back to the main field and just see if any of the other teams have decided to come forward, because the news must certainly have gone back now that the two Spanish riders who were in this group have been left behind, and that will change the whole look of this bike race. Obviously the Belgians will be fairly happy with the presence of one of their riders in here, but one man on the Belgian squad has actually axed the whole of the end of the season towards this World Championships, and that's André Schmeel, recently second in the Paris-Tours World Cup race. He is looking for the big win here, and in fact declined selection for the Olympic Games to concentrate on winning the World Championships.
Well, he's going to thank the Poles that they catch up. The Italians are hovering. Look, all of them with the green jerseys on. Still four Poles setting the pace, and no one is assisting them. The pace, though, is registering the fact that they are bringing them all back. Ever so slowly is the case, but the gap is closing. They should be inside 3.5 minutes at the next time check we get.
I think it's a bit strange to be looking at a World Championships and have names like Jan Ulrich, Lance Armstrong and Alex Zuller absent from the starting list. A real reflection that the majority of the big names can't hold on till the end of the season. And unfortunately, we have had good World Championships, but maybe not all of the best riders in the world are present at the latter part of the season.
In a couple of years' time, these championships on these dates will be in Canada. Well, I am assured that it's an area where the snow doesn't come that early. Let's hope they're right, because otherwise we would be in trouble. But there is a rumour actually coming out of these championships that they are seriously considering now moving the titles back into the end of the summer season, which will be August into September, where of course they always were. I think it's fair enough now, because the Tour of Spain has been a very successful move from April to September, a race in its own right now, much more interesting than it was, and so I think the change is ready.
Absolutely. Christophe Moreau, the larger rider there, rode absolutely superbly in the Tour de France, finishing fourth overall, just losing out in the final time trial to his own teammate, Joseba Beloki. But Danilo De Luca, having gone through that bad patch, is really being encouraged now by the crowd. And what a magnificent crowd this is through the finishing area, Phil. I would say there are in excess of 350,000 spectators today. And if the weather had been good, they were expecting 500,000.
Well, watch the clock. 7 laps to go. These 5 riders must now be feeling the Polish cold air coming up from behind. These are the 4 that were dropped from that group of 9. Remember, they went away on the 4th circuit. We're now 7 from the end of the 19. And they know, they're resigned to the fate now, that shortly they'll be the first to see the Polish boys close it down.
Well, the fire has gone out of these guys now, and they will know that fairly shortly they will feel the breath of the Polish squad on their backs, because the Poles are doing a magnificent job on the front of the main field trying to pull this race back together. And the fact that that leading group now has split into 2 groups of 5 and 4, I think we will see the whole race coming back together. But it's going to be a long, hard chase by the Poles. This group now of 4 filled just out, just inside 1 minute in arrears of the leading group of 5.
Yes, they've more or less given up now. Once they drop, there's no point in continuing on. You may as well just ride round till the peloton picks you up and see if there's anything left in those legs. Back into the danger zone, which is there's the French with all the bags hanging out. But it looks as though Francis Moreau, yes, he got one. He's had an unfortunate season this year. He's had 2 crashes very early on. Francis Moreau broke his collarbone in the first one, then fractured his skull in the second. But at least he's got himself back into form.
Second group of 4 riders here, the 2 Spaniards on the front there, Diaz Justo and Eladio Jimenez. Jimenez taking a stage victory in the Vuelta a España, and certainly regarded by many as one of the great Spanish hopes for the future. A huge turnaround in Spanish cycling, when a few years ago one wouldn't have expected to see the Spanish being so competitive in the one-day world championships. But since Abraham Olano took their first title in Colombia, and then followed that up last year with a win by Oscar Freire, I think they're fancying their chances today. And Oscar Freire, for me, Phil, still has to be a super chance at the finish, because this circuit is not a circuit for the major climbers. And if it's a group of riders of 25 or 30 left towards the end, then really Oscar Freire has a chance of being one of the rare world champions to take the title twice on the road.
Well, that would be rather nice for Freire, especially after his surprise victory last year, with his great season that has followed since. De Luca on the left of our picture, man of quality, I think, and we'll be very happy the way things are going. With 7 laps to go, here's the bunch. Now, are they coming to the start-finishing line? If so, the clock will be on them. It's not long since the leaders have gone through. They are getting much closer than they were. It was 3.5 minutes, but I think the effort by the Poles has slashed that right down now.
Still an awful lot of bike riders left in the event at the moment. The amazing thing about the World Championships is it's this constant pressure. And there you can see the Spaniards fill in about 10th position there, still looking pretty comfortable, pretty happy with the situation. Axel Merckx was still in the main field there, looking quite comfortable. And Gordon McCauley, I think I caught a sign of there, the Kiwi rider. Just 2 Kiwis in the field here, one Chris Jenner, the other McCauley. And down there you can see that there is still a very large field left in the professional world championships.
Well, these boys haven't really turned the pedal in anger. They've sat behind the poles. There's the gap, though, still quite a considerable one. They've really held on here. 3:24 it is now at 7 to go.
That's really going to hurt the Polish team later on, and everybody else for the moment pretty happy just to sit back and allow them to set all the pacemaking at the front. Alexander Vinokurov still in the main field, a glimpse of him. There's the other Estonian rider, Jan Kersipuu. Kersipuu, another man that if the race doesn't toughen up towards the end, there in fact is Andrei Schmeel, still looking very comfortable. Strange way to eat a bottle, but maybe he's just found a different way of drinking.
He'll never get it down, no matter how hard he tries. But Schmeel will feel things are under control just now. There's a nice view again of the town of Pluie. This race on the outskirts. The town itself is full of narrow streets, and you couldn't run the race through there. So they're on the outskirts here as the peloton, still a big one, speeds on its way, still working out how they're going to close the gap, because the last time round it was 3.5. They've only knocked 7 seconds off this time, and that's not an indication they're going to wipe them out yet. The Poles are going to request some help soon, I think.
Well, 54 seconds, that group of 4 is in arrears of the leading group of 5 in the main field, 3.5 minutes behind right now. And all of the pressure, Phil, still coming from that Polish squad. These are the 4 riders caught in the middle. Walter Beneteau is number 25, rides for the Bonjour team. And the two Spaniards, they really did get caught out there, Díaz Justo and Eladio Jiménez. And Sergei Lelekin, well, I think he's just pretty happy to be there, because Lelekin is not a rider on one of the top international teams. In fact, this is the first time I've seen Lelekin racing, and he must be pretty happy to be at the front of the World Championships. A big chance for a rider like him to interest the sponsors and possibly ride into a professional squad for next season.
Well, Beneteau there got round his first Tour de France this year. He's only a youngster. Another one of the finds, I think. Finished 71st. But the fact was he finished, and he seems to have come here determined to establish at least an impression on the event.
Well, another team coming to the front now. It may well be red and white, but this time, in fact, it's the Danish team who have decided to send one or two riders further forward. They've seen the big pressure that the Poles have been put under and decided now is the time to come forward and help out in the organisation at the front of this pack. And now that we are getting another team interested, it may well be a time that the main group in front will start to get pulled back. The thing about the Danish team is we did see a very impressive Rolf Sørensen a week ago in Paris-Tours, and it may well be that Rolf is looking for the biggest title of his career. He's won almost every major one-day race that there is on the calendar, but he's never been world champion.
This is the dangerous stretch. We've had quite a few little tumbles here with the women juniors and the espoirs coming down this section on the sharp left hand. I think it's Allan Johansson who's on the front. He's a sort of elder statesman now of the Danish riders, but even so, he was a late turning professional and he is a strong man. So they'll welcome him at the front, and the Poles could do with a break anyway, because I don't know how many laps have been chasing him, at least four.
Very difficult for them, and this is the technical part of the course. And I tell you one thing, you don't want to be in 30th or 40th position right now, because you're hanging right onto the wheel of the rider in front of you. There are the four riders who were caught in no man's land, so they're just about to get brought back into the fold. And so now the race situation will be the five leaders with the rest of the main pack together.
About to swoop round a roundabout, and the four riders round it first on the inside track. There's the field right onto them now, so the field will soon work out they haven't got them all, if they didn't know already. And they'll assess who they've caught and who they haven't. There they are, the two Spanish, the Russian and the Frenchman are back in the fold. Where's the other Spanish rider? He'll be around somewhere.
Well, now that this situation has happened on the road, I think we may well see Spain coming forward as well, Phil, because Oscar Freire must certainly be a serious challenger for the title if they can keep a large group together. And it seems for the moment as if there hasn't been too much devastation at the back of this pack, and it is a very large group. The whistles and the shouts going forward now from the Poles. The Poles realising that Spain now don't have any riders in the front, so they've cut off the power, they've set up. And now I think we will see a change in the front of the main field.
I think you're right. They've now said that the other boys have got no excuse now for not giving us a hand. So if they won't do it, then we won't bother either. And the reaction coming straight away from Spain. That was a good decision by the Polish riders. Otherwise, these boys would have thanked them all the way to the finish and then taken the medals. Now Spain go out on the attack.
Well, that's a bit strange. Spain there not really wanting to come to the front and organise a chase and deciding to launch a man off the front. Not a very sensible move at this stage in the game, because those riders are still more than 2.5 minutes in front, and trying to ride across a gap like that at the World Championships is basically a waste of energy.
Well, he's a tall boy, and the tall boy which comes to mind is Martin Perdiguero, who is on the attack here. And the riders try to reorganise themselves to see if they can get the counteraction going. Remember that there's still five riders, 3 minutes and 20 seconds ahead.
This is a tough course. You can actually see, looking at the pavement out there as well, that it's not a smooth surface here. These Breton roads, the small roads away from the main highways, are very, very rough, and they're not really rolling it along as well. It's very difficult to get any kind of moving. This, in fact, looks very much like Jose Enrique Gutierrez, who's going forward.
I told you it was Perdiguero, didn't I?
I know you did. You've always been good on your Spanish riders. You can see that was a clever move, though, by the Spanish. This is how he got away. He had a teammate on his wheel there, and as soon as they got to the front of the pack, he sat up and allowed this man to go clear. But I don't think he's too far off the front of the main pack right now.
What a great season Kell may have had, too. Running out team winners in the Tour de France. Wonderful performance. And challenges all of the way. And now we've got Heras, winner of the Tour of Spain. Rumours, by the way, he might move across to Lance Armstrong's side.
Well, that would be an incredible move for the US Postal Service team. though he does still hold a valid contract with the Kelme squad. It is an interesting move for him to move across there. He said that he made those contacts well before the Tour of Spain. He's very interested to ride along Armstrong and learn how to ride time trials. He feels that he would be a much more improved rider riding alongside Armstrong for a couple of years and maybe then have a crack at winning the Tour de France overall. The main field coming up towards the finishing area, still a huge pack of riders, Phil. Nobody yet has managed to break the stranglehold, and not really a very clever tactical move by the Spanish right now, because they do have a serious challenger for the win in Oscar Ferreira, and they need to get themselves pretty much organized at the front of the pack if they're going to pull that leading group of five back.
Well, this man's proving to be a nice little carrot here now, or a nice large carrot actually, in Gutierrez. We're looking down, riders trying to get away from the front of the pack. The sign writers have been busy. Well, this is an interesting attack. The Polish rider still setting the pace, trying to keep everybody on the toes. It's a tough one. This is Piotr Radecki, the Moroz rider. He's had a good day. There are three riders on the Moroz team made the selection for the Polish team, and I think they've got eight men on the start line today.
Wodecki wearing a slightly different jersey to the rest of the team there, and I'm not sure that's allowed at the World Championships. He's actually wearing the Polish National Road Racing Champions jersey, and at the World Championships you're supposed to wear the national jersey of your country, but today he's decided to opt for that. He may well find himself getting a slight fine from the Union Cycliste Internationale. He's two-time national champion of Poland, actually took the time trial championships as well.
Well, the design's the same, it's just the writing on the top alters a bit, so they might get away with that. Anyway, it looks as though Gonzalez is getting away with nothing, because he's been, Gutierrez rather, he's being caught. And now the Italians, and this is Bettini, who are now trying to stir things up a bit. They've sensed it's getting time. Now Di Luca may not be too happy with this.
Surprised to see. I think he just wants to pull the Spanish rider back into the fold right there. A little test of the legs to see how everybody else was going to attack. Gutierrez looks over his shoulder, realizes it's all over right now. And it's still the Polish coming to the front. That is Zevgini Spruch there moving forward. You can see the blue and pink shorts of the Lamprey squad. He too coming forward right now just to show the team that he is there, still in the bike race. But he shouldn't have come off the front like that right now.
Well, that bunch is thinning out rather dramatically now. Gutierrez is showing his resistance, but now it's all over. Now the serious boys are beginning to fire. This looks like it being a good lap, and surely it was 3:24 last time around. This, and that was a 19:35 lap, by the way. Surely now on lap 13, we're going to see that gap come down.
Well, the hammer now starting to come down a little more. Everybody trying to raise the tempo in this main field, but you can always see when it's hurting, because riders looking over their shoulders to see if the gaps are appearing in the main field, and they're not right now. There's a couple of Dutch riders moving forward there. Michael Bogaard is in the group quite comfortably. There's Scotty Sunderland halfway down the pack, looking further down the main field. A lot of these riders really are starting to suffer right now.
Yes, this is the crunch period. There's always stages of a World Championship when you have to grit your teeth and hope you survive to come through the other end, and this is one of those periods now. At around 180 kilometres covered, some 80 kilometres still to race, they've got to answer the pressure being put on. We're chasing at five survivors of nine, and the gap is coming down.
It's not coming down very rapidly at the moment though, as Alexander Vinokourov comes to the front here, the rider from Kazakhstan, Olympic silver medalist, a magnificent bike rider, one of a great Kazakhstan international amateur team who raced all over the world and then literally exploded nearly every one of those riders getting a professional contract. You can see the pressure now as people move left and right in that front of that spearhead, trying to be near the front but not wanting to put their noses into the wind at the moment.
Don't blame them. Back up to the front runners. Another lap can be ticked off here, reaching the 184 kilometre point. And then the clock will start and we'll see what they've got. That's Beauchat of Switzerland. Quite like the Swiss team colours as they come through. And I like the new Italian colours too. De Luca's wearing those, sat at the back. These riders have been away now since the 60th kilometre, so 120 kilometres in the lead, which is some 70 miles out front. 4 hours 22 as they go out on lap 14.
six laps remaining. Bouchard's had a pretty reasonable season. He's a young rider with one victory to his credit, and that was just a couple of weeks ago in the Hessen Rundfahrt when he took out the second stage. As Austria moves to the front, there in the middle for France is Brochard. There's a Frenchman there on the left-hand side with a slight problem, and that looks very much as if it's Laurent Jalabert got his arm in the air.
Well, now this is a far more serious situation for Jalabert if he has. Laurent Brochard going through camera now. He's also right at the sharp end, looking for the move, perhaps. This is the area now. You must hold position. There's poor old Jalabert there. But must have a flat tyre.
He has a serious problem. His hand has been up. He's looking over to see if there are any teammates around right now. And I wonder, there's the French team car right at the front of the pack. But this is not the time to have an incident, because the pressure is pretty much on at the front of the pack right now. And if he finds himself off the back with a mechanical incident, he's going to have a hard time getting himself back into the race.
Just look at Radetzky here. Drive this race on. He is going like a train. It's a bit of a performance for the crowd, I think, this, to the start-finishing line. But he's going well. Brochard sprinting up on the left of our picture, trying to join three men on the attack. There's the tying up. My goodness me, it's come down this time. 2 minutes, 8 seconds the gap.
It's still been a very long and hard chase, Phil, to pull back from 4.5 minutes to 2 minutes. But I do feel now that we will see the end of that leading group of five fairly shortly. Well, another man has climbed into the pits. This is Frédéric Pinot of France. And this is the part of the race now where we can expect more and more riders to pull away from the race. 1 minute 55 seconds is the official time on the board for the five riders at the front of the bike race. And still, Christophe Moreau is the man really keeping the pressure on. He's the man who's got the most to gain from a situation like this, as well as Danilo De Luca in second position there. De Luca must be just keeping his fingers crossed and hoping there's going to be some tactical manoeuvres in the main field behind, but that doesn't happen at the World Championships. Once you get to the critical part of the race, the hammer really does start to go down, and Brochard is the man putting the hammer down right now. He's going off the front of the pack, Phil, and you can hear the French crowd.
Well, we're looking at the man who has won the world title in the past, facing all sorts of accusations that he may have won it on drugs, but that's what's coming out of the Festina affair, of which Brochard is very much a part of that. But right now he's trying to redeem himself here as he tries to rip clear of the field. Ideally he wants a small group with him.
Belgians sending a man up there to try and get onto the tail. It looked like Nico Martin moving forward. It isn't, in fact, Nico Martin. It's one of the old other Belgian riders. That's Michael Van Haker, who's got across. He's not a rider we see an awful lot of on the international circuit. The man I feel they're working for today must be André Schmiel. And at the back of the pack, we are hearing over race radio that there is a problem with Laurent Jalabert.
Well, that's a real shame. The question is, he's going to be very unlucky, because the hammer has gone down right at the moment he slid off the back of the field. We're now on to lap 14 here, 185 kilometres covered for the main field. The leader's just a little bit further ahead, but not by much now. They're probably inside 2 minutes now after this flurry of attacks.
I'll tell you what, the hammer is really down right now. Everybody is trying to get off the front. Everybody is trying to form the counter-attack in pursuit of those five leaders at the moment. Their advantage has come down pretty rapidly. It was at one time 4.5 minutes. It's now well inside of 2 minutes, and the speed is obviously different in the main field. You can see the difference in the speed. These riders, Phil, now are approaching 50 kilometres an hour, and this lap, if they keep this pressure on, is going to be pretty close to the fastest so far.
But the impetus is slipping just a bit as that flurry of attacks has been brought back to heel. The riders looking for who's going to move next. The lap time itself was not great, 19.35 followed by a 19.41. So nothing approaching the 18.09 done when the original break went away on lap four.
Christophe Moreau leading them into the finishing straight. There is Danilo De Luca. De Luca's a magnificent bike rider, and there's been some incredible sums of money bandied around to try and pick up this bike rider. Sums of money well in excess of the $1 million per year, and I certainly think that he's going to be a great bike rider. Very cocky for the moment, knows exactly what he wants to do, and he so dearly wanted the Maglia Rossa in the Giro d'Italia this year. The huge crowd is not, though, for Danilo De Luca with the green shirt there. It's for Christophe Moreau, the French representative in this leading group of five.
200 kilometres, give or take a kilometre, under the wheels now. And this is, looks as though Mathieu Pronk has been left, has he, by the leaders? gritting his teeth anyway. Spot of bother, he was in the breakaway, but he's in trouble now.
Well, that's a surprise. He may well have had a mechanical incident because he seemed to be riding fairly well there. He's 30 seconds or more in arrears of that leading group of riders.
He must have punctured. We never heard about that, but he must have punctured as he goes into five laps to go.
Bit of calm coming to the front of the main field right now, but you can notice now the organization starting to come in from the Italians. A lot of those green shouldered jerseys moving to the front. That's the Italian squad, the new Italian strip. They've got a pretty good role to play here right now because they have Danilo De Luca in the leading group of riders, but they also have Michele Bartoli. Bartoli just on the right hand side there with the tricolore helmet on, that helmet indicating he's the national champion of Italy this year. And he likes this circuit. He said openly when he won the Grand Prix of Plouay in the month of August that he'd like to come back in a couple of months' time and find himself crowned the world champion. He was the super favourite before the start of the championships, and for the moment he hasn't made a wrong move.
And these three riders surviving here now, four riders, Beauchat sitting on the back of them. I don't know if you noticed Bartoli there, Paul. He's still got his top jersey on, his zip-up top. I mean, that's something you wouldn't normally see in a world championship with some five laps still to race.
Still pretty cool for the moment. There is his teammate Paolo Bettini, wears 39 in second position, right up against the barriers right now. But the main field, slowly but surely, starting to reduce in numbers, and it's in the last two or three laps we'll see riders disappearing from this group. It's still pretty big though for this state of a world championship. Five laps still to go to the finish, and a huge convoy of cars behind the riders. All the major nations are allowed to bring 12 riders to the world championships, and the lesser teams are allowed to bring just eight. The defending team, which is in this instance Spain, would have been allowed to start 13 riders here at the world championships, Alano being the 13th man, and he in fact decided to take his dummy and go home after he was beaten in the individual time trial. But it's a big advantage, and this is all decided on the rankings of the teams in the international field. The UCI ranks all of the countries, and if you finish in the top six, you're allowed to bring 12 riders to the world championships.
Just sort of caught a glimpse there at the head of the field of Chan McRae, who had a great ride last year and finished fifth. I think he's the only survivor left in now of the Americans. I think all of the others, there weren't many of them, are now out. Antonio Cruz, who also rode in the World Championships, Danny Pate and Fred Rodriguez, haven't seen Fred at all, the American champion, but McRae's still certainly at the thick end of the race.
Pretty close to the front there, wearing 36, is Richard Vironc. And I wonder what's going through his mind right now as Matej Pronk has been caught. That leaves just four riders at the front of the World Championships right now, and their advantage is coming down all of the time.
I just had the feeling that Pronk did have a flat tyre there, but anyway, it doesn't matter now. He's back in the field. Of the nine originals, four survive as the race continues to chase them all down. Still one or two Belgians there. They are working, of course, for André Schmil. Bartoli tucked in nicely. How he would like to round off his season with a world title. There he is over to the right. No, there he is, gone now. I don't know where he's gone.
He's keeping pretty close. He's in the first five or six riders there, just off to the right-hand side. He's keeping himself off the front of the main field right now, but also as close to the front as possible in case there are any surprise attacks. Right in the middle there is Axel Merckx in the Belgian jersey, just going off to the left. There he is now with the orange jersey on right now. Big, strong rider, Axel. Looking pretty nervous right now, looking over his shoulder. Probably wants to know the whereabouts of André Schmil. What a great season Axel has had. He's brought his dad an awful lot of emotion. A great individual stage victory in the Giro d'Italia, when I could not believe that he would come back after a dramatic crash. And then in the month of June, he took the national championships, and it's been a long time since the Belgians have seen the name Merckx right at the top of the leaderboard. And I tell you one thing, they say that Eddie was actually there commentating for Belgian television, and they had to rip the microphone away from him with about 10 kilometres to go.
Well, you know, Merckx followed by Merckx is a pretty sensational thing to happen, because apart from Johan Museeuw and a couple of flurries by one or two other riders, there hasn't been much to shout for in Belgium in recent years. The Italians at the minute are doing everything right. They've got all of their players at the front. The Spanish riders are riding in defence of Oscar Freire again. It's an interesting move, this. The big guns are firing. The big teams, who boast 12 starters, are now showing the advantage of having so many riders on the start line.
Well-drilled squads coming forward now, getting team tactics, and I do feel that the Spanish really only have one major chance in their ranks, and that is the defending champion Oscar Ferreira, and that would be pretty impressive if he could make it two in a row. The last time that was done by Gianni Bugno, and it's very rare for a world title to happen twice in succession. The field does look to be reducing in numbers somewhat, and it really is becoming a war of attrition as we rejoin the four leaders, and they're looking a little bit more ragged than they did earlier on. This climb, although not very much if you do it just on one occasion, after 5 or 6 hours in the saddle, really does start to become quite a mountain. It feels as if somebody's got a hydraulic jack underneath it and they're lifting it up each time you come around.
Those legs are not going to make it to the finish on these four riders, and there's the reason why. 1:10 now, back to the peloton. Robbie Hunter, the latest rider to reach our ears from South Africa, who's now retired.
Well, in fact, although the time gap was just over the 1 minute, I've noticed they're pushing all of the cars out of the gap right now, and these guys know what that means. That's why Marichal there from Belgium is looking over his shoulder. It means once they start pushing all of the cars out of the way that the gap is coming down pretty rapidly. And the last time check of 1 minute, I think when we pull back, may well only be 30 seconds.
Well, they are on a hill. And we haven't found them yet. There they are. No, I think you're right. 50 seconds is probably the gap now. They're coming very quickly. And when the capture arrives, as it surely will, then we're going to see a flurry of attacks, I am sure. Because there are far too many riders here dreaming of a rainbow jersey right now.
Still a lot of big names in this group. Sergei Ivanov was still there for Russia. Looking a little bit further down the pack. Scotty Sunderland is still in there as well for Australia. Caught a quick glimpse of him. This man here is Roberto Laiseca, the man we saw taking a stage victory at the Vuelta a España, a very good bike rider, finished high in the overall rankings as well. Spain on the front, completely organized, trying to pull this back, trying to keep a large group together for their man, the defending champion Oscar Freire.
And Richard Wawrynka is also there now, center left of our picture, and still looking pretty cool here. 54 seconds, so that wasn't a bad guess by us, was it, as they now start to close in. This is going to be a most interesting move here now.
Siewgeni Spruch, Polish rider on the right-hand side. He now has to ride very close to the front of the pack after all of the work that was done by his teammates to pull back that advantage, which at one time was 4.5 minutes. Wawrynka looking over to see where everybody else is. There is André Schmeel a little further back in the light blue jersey of the Belgians. And if we can have a look further down the field, we'll get a chance to see if Laurent Jalabert managed to get himself back into the main field. There is Oscar Freire, Phil, wearing number one there, pretty close to the front of the pack. Magnificent bike rider, defending champion, and looking very seriously as a major contender here to take the win twice.
And the only Aussie left in the race, I think, now. Scott Sunderland is right up there as well. Like Andrea Taffy, he's got a point to prove. Max Chandri still going through there. There's still two of the three British riders in this race. The other one didn't start, by the way. John Tanner and Charlie Vergelius. Sorry, Max Chandri and Charlie Vergelius are the two riders left in this race, and they're both up there too.
Looking down that long main field there, I didn't catch much of a sign of Laurent Jalabert, but it's very easy to hide in the main pack. The four leaders over the top of the climb now starting to organize themselves just a little bit. Marichal is the man in first place. Danilo De Luca's face not giving anything away right now, but I think he realizes he's had his chance of glory at the World Championships. It's been a major help for the Italians, but basically for these four riders, as the pace picks up towards the end, they will get caught and probably spat out of the back.
But it's still been a superb ride. Over 100 miles in the lead now for those four survivors of the nine who escaped originally, as again the Italians now trying to take control and trying desperately now to reduce that lead. Often wonder, Paul, why Italians are chasing an Italian.
I think they've realised now that the race is over. They realise that the fact is those four riders have been in the breakaway situation for a long time, and maybe the word has come back that in fact Danilo De Luca is not in excellent form. He's not certainly going to win. And the Italians feel that this is the moment they really need to put that out. This is Michele Bartoli, El Gatto, the cat they call him. He's coming out of the front of the pack right now. He knows this course. This is where he won the Grand Prix of Plouay. And this is the first major serious attack of the race.
Well, Bartoli now trying to rip this field to shreds here as we go into the closing laps of the event. There's still De Luca up in the front. He'll be not happy at the thought. The Italians are throwing their best men at the race now to reduce that lead, but we are inside a minute, well inside a minute now to those leaders. We say bye-bye to Plouay again as we move out on these closing laps of the World Championship.
That attack hurt. The Italian in third position there is Davide Rebellin. Michael Bogart is there in the orange. I'm not quite sure what Michele wants. Come on, boys, let's get working. He looks over his shoulder to see what sort of damage has been done. Not really enough for the moment. There's still an awful lot of bike riders still in contact.
Well, the thing was, I didn't see Schmil making that break, so there was no reason for the Belgian rider to start working there. And besides, Bartoli is not slow in cajoling everybody into action. It's a question of whether you're strong enough to say no thanks.
When he looks over his shoulder here, he sees that they've got the gap here, and he's saying go, 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 because we have a gap, but nobody else wants to. The Belgian orders are obviously there. You can see that they're not going to work at all unless André Schmil is in the front split of riders. A general regrouping once again happening in this bike race, but that was a pretty serious attack there by Michele Bartoli.
Yes, it's one of those occasions I wish a camera was at the back of the race, because I'm quite sure we lost a few riders with that flurry of activity.
Absolutely. Many riders will have been put under pressure there, but they need to keep this pressure on over the top. Otherwise, riders will recover. They have a slight gap over the rest of the field right now as Paolo Bettini comes forward to insist and accelerate. A lot of Mappe riders in this Italian selection, but they haven't split the main field right now, Phil. There will be one or two riders at the back suffering, but there's still around about 60 riders in this group.
All coming back together again. It's being left to the Italians now to drive on all of the time.
Maximilian Schanri riding pretty much to the front, very much in the autumn of his career now, Max, but still having, I reckon, a pretty good season. He was so close to getting himself a stage victory in the Giro d'Italia earlier this year. He then was selected for the Great Britain team for the Olympic Games, and here at this crunch time riding very well to the front of the pack at the World Championships.
There's the view of the farmland around Plouay. As the field now work out how they can bridge a gap of some 35 seconds. It's not much more than that to the leaders. And they're all having a go now. The Swiss riders getting into the action. And this looks to me like André Schmil. Now they're going to have to react to this one.
Schmil looking very strong. He's dedicated the whole latter half of his season to this World Championships right now, and that really has caught the Italians hopping. The Italians looking over their shoulders now. They want to organise the chase at the front, but they need to chase down pretty rapidly. I can't really get an ID on the Swiss rider in there, but that is definitely André Schmil. They haven't got very much of an advantage over the pack, but they are coming now to the fairly technical part of the course, so this is a possibility to open up the gap.
Well, the field, the message will soon spread down that Schmil is getting a bit active now. That peloton still, though, very unwieldy and quite large. This is back up to the leaders, but now it's all over. The leaders are the main field, as all of a sudden they've wiped it all out. And after more than 100 miles in the lead, the World Championship is again up for grabs.
First man to make the junction there is André Schmil, but the main field are not really very far behind at the moment. And over the next few laps, Phil, every time we hit that climb up through the finishing straight in Plouay, there will be attacks. They'll be trying to force a small group of riders off the front. They're sitting up right now. This is a moment, a lull, having caught the four leaders. Everybody's trying to reascertain the tactics, who they need to launch forward onto the attack. But certainly André Schmil there in the middle of the picture announcing the colours. He's in form and wants to take out the win here.
Well, he's a frisky man at this stage of any race. 2.5 laps still to go. And anybody in with a shout now, and for quite unusually for the World Championship, there's a lot of big teams with a lot of men left at the sharp end of this race. The Italians, the Spanish, the French, the top Belgians are still there as well. This is the corner that's caught so many people off guard, but it looks as though they're coming round it safely again.
Still Danilo De Luca there on the front. He will, I would think, drift back a little bit. Now, this is the rear of the pack. Now, this is rather interesting here because the man we're looking at right now is, in fact, Laurent Jalabert, who's riding himself into the pits. He was having serious difficulty there before, Phil, and he's now climbing off. And right up there alongside him is Gilles Bouvard. So that's a blow for the French, and I'm sure it's very much a psychological blow for Laurent Jalabert because of the worry of whether or not he has a contract for next season.
Yes, it wasn't quite what he had in his mind, I don't think, but there we are. That's the way it goes. This is now an attack by Nicky Ebersold. I think it is. It might be Beat Zeberg, was it?
Beat Zeberg it was, the brother of Marcus Zeberg, a very good bike rider. These two guys normally spend their season riding for the Rabobank team. Marcus Zeberg, if it does come down to a large group sprint at the end, is another man who has a serious chance of taking out a victory. This is the move by Zeberg. The Italian's controlling the front of the main pack, but he's decided he's going to go out, and it's always going to be on this slope up through the finishing straight towards the summit of the climb outside of Plouay.
Well, we've had some wet days this week, but we've seen some excellent bike racing, I have to say. And how wonderful it was to see Mari Holden win the gold medal in the time trial, beating Jenny Longo, a rider she'd never beaten until this year. She beat her in the Olympics to the silver and in the Worlds to the gold.
26 kilometres to go. Zeberg hasn't really got much of an advantage over the main field, but look how easy André Schmeel looks there, Phil. He looks over his shoulder to look at the faces of the other bike riders in this event here and moves forward just to make sure that he's at the front of the pack. I think this man is in excellent form today. In about fifth or sixth position there in the multicoloured jersey with the red and blue sleeves is Maximilian Chiandri. On the right in the orange is Mikkel Bogaert. And that group now has seriously been reduced in numbers because of all those accelerations. But what a crowd on the finishing line.
Fabulous atmosphere here as Max Chiandri for Britain. And here he is right on the front now. He's a man for championships, bronze medal in the Olympic Games 4 years ago in Atlanta. And wants to see if anybody's going to give him a hand here. Mikkel Bogaert is the rider in the orange Dutch colours. But there's a little bit of a truce just been called for the minute at least.
Well, Chiandri started off the season very well with a win in a stage race in South Africa at the Vodacom Rapport Tour. But I think more importantly for him, Phil, was the win that he got in the Tour of Lazio just before the Olympic Games. Brochard now on the left-hand side, accelerating, trying to get himself off the front of the pack. A big bike rider, very popular in France, but still got that black cloud over his head because of his involvement with that Festina affair.
So Laurent Brochard, he might well be the team leader of the French now because there aren't that many of them left. Richard Virenque is in there somewhere. But apart from that, I don't think they've got many people left in the race.
That move was countered by Gianni Farazain, the Italian rider in the middle there, the Mappe rider, as Spain moves forward. A lot of these bike riders now can feel the crunch of this Plouay circuit, a very difficult circuit. And especially when you bear in mind that we're racing in excess of 45 kilometres an hour. Michele Bartoli there in its sixth place, still looking for the move. Nobody yet has managed to break the stranglehold over this field.
Now, big bunch is just strung out, but they're all coming back, you see. Holland on the attack at the minute. And again, that long, thin line, the Italian flag waving quite high now because they'll get more and more confident with the riders they've got left in this race. They surely have got the players to do a work, and this is going to be the start of it now because Bartoli's going again. Looks to see who's followed him. I can't see. It might be Schmeel. I can't quite see behind him.
It is Schmeel.
I think it is.
It is Schmeel. Schmeel is right there. These two riders marking each other very closely, but Chiandri riding well too there in third position. The Italians still in great numbers in this group, Phil, and that is their advantage. If they see the right combination forming at the front, they can have two or three riders just sit up and let the gap go.
So the big boy is beginning to test the water now to see who is the strong man. That's a very typical Bartoli attack, that. As fast as he can go and to see who follows before he continues the pressure. He saw the wrong man on his wheel, André Schmeel, so he stopped up and back in the field. That field is a very tenacious bunch today. It hasn't really thinned out as Max Chiandri's got control of the head now.
Chiandri looking very cool. He shouldn't be riding like this. He's
no.
A lone rider. He doesn't have any team support at the moment. He has to ride his own race. But maybe thinking about moving on to a top squad.
Here.
I think this is pretty funny. I'm Max Chiandri riding for Great Britain all on my own, and I'm putting you guys into difficulty. Michele Bartoli goes again, but look at that, Phil. Right on his wheel there is André Schmeel.
Yes, he won't be laughing now. He had a little joke, I think, with André Schmeel just before Bartoli went. But Bartoli thinks, well, this isn't worth it. Obviously, Andre's marking him now. So it's a free wheel again.
It's a bit strange, this. These guys are beginning to get worried about the fact they're not able to open up a breakaway situation. This is still a very large group of riders for this stage in a World Championships. And maybe the circuit here in Plouay is not quite difficult enough to split the race to pieces. Schmiel now on the attack, being covered here by Spain, but there will be a major reaction behind, and that must certainly come from the Italians. This group very much staying together. As they get closer to the finish, Phil, I'm wondering if we might see a very large group come down to the line here, because nobody so far has been able to get very much more than 10 or 15 metres off the front of this main pack. There are still a couple of the big teams with a large number of representatives present, which means they'll always be able to organise the chase unless exactly the right combination goes off the front. But looking down there, it's a very big pack.
It is very big, but well, I'm always full of admiration for the big stars like Andre Schmiel and Michele Bartoli, always willing to attack and test the water, even though there are so many riders there, having more or less a free ride towards the finish. The big names of cycling never afraid to have a go and see what happens.
Belgium still got quite a number of representatives in the group here. Axel Merckx moving to the front of the pack right now. But this is a tricky part of the course. Next time they come up to the line, they will face one lap to go to the finish.
Lindsay, the rider on the front here, was having a chat with his team car the way he was gripping his racing jersey. That's what his microphone is. All back together again, time for a drink.
It's Axel Merckx in second place there. The Swiss also pretty much at the front. Merckx sliding down through the group, probably will go and have a quick word with Andre Schmiel. Almost 38 years of age, Schmiel, and still super competitive in these one-day races. Kelly Bartoli, I think next time we come to the finishing straight up through Plouay, will try and launch the attack again. I don't think that the climb is quite hard enough. This is Luca Shinto on the front, the super domestique, a great friend of Maximilian Chiandri's. He will ride his heart out for the team, the Squadra Azzurra, right now.
Yes, I saw Luca Shinto win the Tour de Blancavia a couple of years ago. That really is the only win of note he's ever had, and it was a big surprise, but he rode so well. There's the long thin line through beautiful French countryside in the west of France as we course through Brittany now. These are wonderful roads to train on or just to cycle on. If you ever want a holiday, go to Brittany, but you'll find the roads are never flat and the hills are often short and steep.
Goraz Stangalay in fourth position, the Slovenian rider. We saw him win the Commonwealth Bank Cycle Classic last year. That's Axel Merckx there, riding pretty much to the front. Had a very good Olympic road race, did Axel. But I think today, really playing the card of Andre Schmiel. Schmiel in excellent condition. The Swiss rider close to the front there was Mauro Gianetti, wearing number 18. But it's a long, thin line, and still, I think, quite a few riders in this group, Phil, have got pretty fresh legs right now.
Bettini setting the pace. Merckx, for us, is a man of the big day, the big event. He always rises to the occasion, and he's right there again. I'm sure Father Eddie will be watching this with great interest now. The Italians are playing all of their cards right now, and they're not going anywhere as Paolo Bettini sets the pace now.
Just caught a glimpse of Richard Virenque. He's around about 20th place in this group at the moment. Still very much a contender for the last lap here, because may well be we'll find ourselves with a strange break going off the front when we come up to the final ascent up through Plouay. Shinto deciding that as far as he's concerned, he has no hope at all of winning the event, but he does have a hope that Michele Bartoli can take the glory for Italy. Bartoli, before the start of this race, Phil, the super favourite to take out the win. Magnificent win at the Grand Prix of Plouay, said he loved this circuit. He rode very well in the Olympic road race. He just missed out on that move when Jan Ullrich got away with his teammate Andreas Klöden. And although he chased for an awful long time with his teammate Paolo Bettini, they were never able quite to make the junction. So if he can get the world title here, that would be a super revenge.
Just look at Bettini here. Shinto sitting behind him as he drives on continually. Doesn't even look over his shoulder for any help. He just pulls this race through, goes wide for the left-hander. Fabulous riding, never afraid to work. He's not thinking of a world title. Mind you, I remember Stephen Roach doing this for Sean Kelly in Villach in 87. At the end of the day, it was Roach who had to take out the title for Ireland.
Looking as if there are a few riders gone missing from that group right now. Looking down there, they can still see Brochard and Richard Virenque pretty much to the back of this pack.
This is Merckx, isn't it?
No. Very much, yes, it is. It's Axel Merckx going off the front. This is a slight attack by Axel moving forward off the front of the pack, but it looked to me as that was Gianni Farazane moving forward.
Well, climbing up the drag towards the finishing line, we should hear the bell this time, and Axel Merckx has turned around the tactics a little bit by launching that attack.
You can feel the pain right now looking down there. Number one is still in this group as well.
Chan McCrae, the American, a man for the World Championships. He rode a great Giro d'Italia as well. These are the survivors now. There's an awful lot of them.
There's an awful lot starting to have sore legs too. There's a little bit of a gap appearing at the back of the main field. Look at the face of this man though. Second in the recent Paris Tours. The winner of the Tour of Flanders. A magnificent move. Everybody thought the race was over when this man leapt off the front and held on by fractions of a second to win.
Yes, that was a great ride. Now, Italy again launching an attack.
Sevgeny Spruch is right in the action there in fourth position in the white jersey with a red stripe down the middle. The Italian rider on the front right now is Sergio Barbaro. He rides for the Lamprey squad normally. Another move coming, that looks like El Gatto. That looks very much like Michele Bartoli, very low down over the front end of the machine. And this may well be the move. This is the move by Michele Bartoli, but look at the reaction. André Schmiel.
Veritable scramble behind now. Schmiel has marked Bartoli throughout this race. Clearly nailed him down as the number one favourite along with André Schmiel. And every time he's made a move, he's cruised over that gap. He's just cruised over it, and Bartoli will just say, oh, not you again. As the reaction has come from the field, this will hurt. But Michele Bartoli, in this sprinting style he has, stays low on the bars. He looks across at André Schmiel. Schmiel will not come through. I'm not sure if Merckx is back in the pack or whether he's still just in front.
He's back in the pack. The man on the front of the main field right now is Frédéric Guédon, but it's the Spaniards who are reacting. Moving forward, Spain has decided now is the time. That looks very much like Oscar Freire, who's coming forward right now. This is the front of the main field, and I don't think Michele Bartoli will be too happy with the fact that André Schmiel came across there, but he really didn't have the power to open up the gap. And Scotty Sunderland going through there in about 10th position.
He's ridden a very canny race just now, as Scott Sunderland. Never been far from the front, but never been on the front. Michele Bartoli is beginning to lose his temper now. Everywhere he goes, André Schmiel follows, but doesn't assist in the chase, because Schmiel is a man for the late attack, and it's too early.
True Italian temper coming through right now. Bartoli thought that was the move that was going to ride him to a lone victory here at the World Championships, but how easy it was, Phil, that André Schmiel rode across there, and that acceleration by the main field is forming a rather large group at the front. They're split into three groups right now, with more even further back, but they're all sweeping across the road right now, and I think it's all going to come back together once again.
Well, I have to say, if Schmiel did throw his hat in the ring here, that bunch would be cracked up all over the place, and then it would be a race of two or three men. But one rider who we've consistently seen up here is the guy in the orange there, Michael Bogart. A good performance by him today, doing the world of good. He's had a couple of bad seasons.
He certainly has. We saw him as a major contender for a high placing in the Tour de France, and he certainly hasn't lived up to that over the last couple of years.
This must be Michael Andersson of Sweden, surely, isn't it?
Michael Andersson is still in the group. This is one of the Ukrainian riders, I think, pretty close to the front of the pack right now. And Merckx on the left-hand side. Merckx looking very good. He's not the kind of rider you want to allow to get off the front.
Well, Axel Merckx come back to the front again now. Bettini dives across and scrambles as best he can. Rider sitting in the back there, 130. That is Igor Pugacci, the Moldavian. A Moldavian rider. That's a country that André Schmiel used to be a member of. He's gone to Belgium now, and this is the Belgian Axel Merckx on the attack. Axel knows when to attack. He has to attack and finish alone. He's not the world's best sprinter, but he is. Remember his stage win this year in the Giro d'Italia. He took it well coming back to the breakaway. and then going straight past them and winning the stage. And he's going now, and he's going to go at a good time.
This is a good time because there's a lot of marking going on in the back of that group there. Bartoli and Schmiel have been following each other everywhere. Axel Merckx now feel may well just have hit them at the right time, but there was a reaction coming from the Swiss team on the front of the main field. But if Axel can get himself 15 or 20 seconds, I think the way the race is developing right now, he may well be able to move on that advantage, because there are so many riders in the pack still watching each other.
Well, the crowd still cheer, Belgian or no, as he comes up this little drag. There's the Belgian flag now. I'm not sure they saw him go by, but they were certainly waving the right flag. As Merckx has got this little gap now, he had the legs to open it. Now, has he got the legs to stay away? No immediate counter-attack here. It's the Spanish who are having to drive on behind. I think Schmiel at this moment will be rather happy that Merckx has gone clear.
It'll take some pressure off him. He's sitting in that group. And you know, over the last couple of kilometres, there are one or two riders have disappeared off the back of this group, but it is still a very large group. It's the Spanish on the front in second position there. Gianni Farazin still looking very comfortable there, was Andre Schmiel in the group. Merckx's face is really a picture of pain and anguish at the moment. He hasn't really opened up much of an advantage over the gap.
Coming up to the bell though, just one lap to go of the 19 remains. Britain and America have one representative each in that rather diminishing bunch now. Max Chandri and Chan McCrae are the two riders. There's the bell. Just under 6 hours in the saddle. And a massive crowd here giving a lovely atmosphere in Plouay. And the French still have a chance. There, off to the left of our picture, is Richard Veronque. Brochard is in here somewhere as well.
Gianni Farazin is the Italian on the front, and this is a very strange situation. Farazin today riding for Italy. Normally he rides on the same team as Axel Merckx, and that is the Mapei squad. He's putting the pressure on right now, but Axel is not going to lay down arms very easily. If he can just keep this pressure on for another kilometre or so, he may well just break the back of the chase. But the Italians, Phil, are still in very strong numbers, and they will organise themselves at the front of this pack and try and pull him back.
For those of you who remember Dad Eddie racing as I do, then at this point of the race, if Eddie was clear, the rest of the field would have let him go, because they would have had no answer to an attack from Eddie Merckx at this stage of a World Championship event. Not quite the same with son Axel. He's not got the talent of his dad, but he's certainly got the guts, and he's always willing to have a go. And he's got a little gap now, and he's 13 kilometres from a gold medal.
I'll tell you one thing that Eddie Merckx cannot believe is how hard his son works. He's always amazed at the work that Axel puts in to get himself to this level of the sport, and with a name like Merckx on your shoulders, it is not an easy thing to do, but he wears it and carries it with a hell of a lot of pride. I've seen him at training camps, Phil, get up at 6 o'clock in the morning to do weight training and build himself up before going out for a bike ride with the rest of the team.
I can't believe you've seen him, Paul. Somebody must have told you. You'd never be up at 6 o'clock.
No, I was coming home at the time.
Well, I'm afraid for Axel it's almost over here. It's the Spanish who've done the damage, and let's not forget that Oscar Freire is still in there. The man who won the title last year as a surprise, now a totally changed man 12 months on, and the team still working for him. 12 and a half kilometres to go.
Great move, great attack by Axel, but you can see it's Spain who really believe that they've got the winner in their midst, because Oscar Freire is still in this group here. He is one of the fastest sprinters on the block so far this season. The green jersey there moving forward into about 10th place is the Slovenian rider Gorez Stangalaj, and another attack coming off the front of the main field. Again, this looks like Italy on the attack, trying to split this race into pieces, and Axel slipping further back. This is Davide Rebellin on the front. Even Rebellin today, Phil, has decided that he too will work for the team leader of the Squadra Azzurri, the Italian team today, Michele Bartoli. This is what it looks like at the back of the pack, and this is the place you do not want to be.
Rebellin in the race is a kind of consolation prize when they wouldn't let him ride the Olympic Games and put Pantani in. And he's got good form as David Rebellin, and he's working very hard now at the front of this race. There he is. The crowd are going beside themselves. There's Scott Sunderland in that white jersey. Now that would be a turn up if he landed the big one.
Absolutely, what a win that would be for Scotty Sunderland after the career that he's had. It has had so many ups and downs. He nearly lost his life in a dramatic crash where he was run over by the team car of Case Prem. Strangely enough, Case Prem had been his team manager on the previous season. At the back of the pack though, France are not really looking all of that good in a race that's on their own territory. And the man we looked at there, Jean-Cyril Robin, was a former medalist at the World Championships just 12 months ago.
Indeed he was. Now we've got Switzerland driving at the front. These are now the final selection of this year's World Championship. They got off to a slow start. They allowed a breakaway of 9 to run for most of the race. And now the real stars of the race have thrown everything they've got into the attacks, and they've been monitored and marshalled and put back in the pack.
Sixth position there is Oscar Ferreira. He must be feeling pretty confident right now. The outgoing world champion is just hoping that this group will stay together, because he is the sprinter of the group. The others, I think, have got to try and slip away from this event, because he is another attack. Schmiel again, this man will not give up. Been reproached so many times in his career as being a follower, but he's certainly not doing that now.
I was about to say, if you're a betting person who likes a flutter, go out and guess which kilometre Schmiel will attack. And he's done it already. This is a huge effort. He's gone early for my money, because he's gone with what, about 11 kilometres to go here, and he's got the hill still to come. It might be a good psychological time to go, because they may think he's gone too early.
Well, that's what they said in the Tour of Flanders, if you remember, when he rode off the front, that nobody's going to attack that far from the end in front of a large group. He did that and held a 10-15 second advantage all the way down to the finish. He now has around about 4 or 5 second advantage, but the pressure is on in that main field, Phil. It's a big long line, and I would say if we got down there a little closer, we'd see a Spanish jersey on the front.
Well, you know, André Schmiel has made no secret of the fact he was training for this. He turned his back on the Olympic Games to ride the World Championship. He still has a target of the World Cup, which he is the defending holder. This is the attack. A little bit of a playback here. The Spanish riders all looking at him, but not having the legs to reach him. Now they're trying to settle in here with a bit of work being done by Beltran.
Serious names we're used to hearing at races like the Tour de France and the Vuelta a España, but Spain getting themselves organised, and they still have a large number of riders in this group. 3 Spanish riders moving to the front right now, Phil, to organise the chase. They want to pull André Schmiel back into the fold, because they will then try and set up the sprint victory for Oscar Ferreira. This, though, is an incredible move by André Schmiel, approaching 38 years of age, and he's still got the guts and the determination to go out and race. His excuse for that is that he turned professional very late in life. He was a member of the Soviet Union team that went all over the world in the days of amateurs and professionals, and he turned professional very late on in life, but still has the thrill and the drive to go out on the attack. And you know what, I think he may well have hit them right.
Well, his best ever position in a world championship was 6th. He got that a long time ago, 7 years ago in fact, but he's been a man of the single day races. Holds that corner tight. He really should have taken a wider sweep, but nevertheless, he's accelerating away again. This is his big move now, André Schmiel. He's seen his teammate Merckx try and fail. Now he's committed himself to the action here. There's not a long way to go, but it is still long if you're holding off the best in the world.
Still only around about 100 metres. There he is. It doesn't seem like very far, but for the moment, they're having a hard time nailing down that gap. The Spanish team are the ones who've taken the responsibility on the front of the pack. Michele Bartoli has not been able to get off the front of this group, so I think they've decided to lay down arms for the moment and wait till they get a little closer to the finish. But Spain are in the driving seat right now. In the middle of that pack is Oscar Ferreira. There on the far side is the Italian Farazain. But this man, Phil, is really going for it. It's a do or die effort right now. He has not got a second chance.
The head of the race, the crowd's now conspicuous by their absence, the majority heading down for the finish line to see the race come in. André Schmiel, the grand favourite, alongside Michele Bartoli before the start, is making his bold bid, and it is a bold bid as well. This is the shaky bit of the course. He rocks and rolls a little bit on these corners, but he knows the bunch will have much more difficulty in getting round them than he has.
Got to take all of the risks in these corners, but he doesn't want to push himself, so he falls off. He's round there pretty safely now. The road is almost dry, and it's not a tricky road because of the fact the pavement is fairly rough. He's not likely to see those wheels slip from underneath him. As soon as he gets to a straight part of the course, though, he's picking up the acceleration again to maximum speed, and here he's looking at 55 kilometres an hour on this descent.
Well, this is a superb ride. I don't think anybody would be disappointed if a man like Schmiel got the world title. He'd be a very just holder of it. He's been a 6-day winner. a single day winner rather, for many, many years. And now it looks as though he may have broken the spirit of the chase.
I'm not sure that he has. It looks as if they're closing down on him now. They're getting themselves organized at the front of that pack. It has never really been very much more than 5 or 6 seconds at the moment. And there's another color of jersey moving forward now. It's pale blue, and I would say that is probably Italy who've sent a few riders up to the front of this pack. And it is Italy. That's Gianni Farazin. A little bit of a bounce here with the camera, but it's a high-speed action now all the way down to the finish line. And the fact that Spain and Italy are joining forces, Phil, I think it's going to put paid to this man's escape.
A dire effort now by the Belgian rider. As he tries, and he says, no, I'm going to have to save some energy and try and go again. There's still time to do that. He's realised he hasn't broken the spirit of this race, who is coming back up alongside him. This could well turn out to be a massive bunch sprint for the world title. Italy shut it down now, followed by Axel Merckx. They're all back together again now. The Spanish riders are there. The other Spanish rider, by the way, is Rubiera, number 10. And now Belgium launches another attack. There are a lot of riders here.
Still an awful lot of riders in this group. Surprising to see the Belgians throwing another man out there. Chris Pierce is going off the front right now. And I'm going to have to throw it over to you, Phil, because I can't remember the last time there was such a large group coming down towards the finish line at the end of a World Championships.
Well, I think I'll throw it back, Paul, because I'm not sure I can either without getting all the bucks out. This has been a fabulous World Championship in the last couple of laps. I can't say it's been a record breaker earlier on. But there's been a lot of boys here believe in themselves and believe that they have their men on their team. The Spanish are riding their hearts out now for a repeat win of Oscar Freire. He started off with wins right at the start of the season to show us he was a world champion. And now, well, wouldn't it be great if he took the world title into the year 2001? He can't blame his team because they are riding a wonderful race right now.
Absolutely magnificent. Marcel Strauss is the Swiss rider on the back of the main field here, but really the action is all at the front. Goraz Stengele is the rider in the green jersey, the Slovenian rider, but the big organisation on the front of this pack is coming from the Amarillo red and white jerseys of Spain. They will ride as fast as they can down into the finishing town here off Plouay, and that's when they hope they will set up the sprint for their man wearing number one there, Oscar Freire, the outgoing world champion.
Javier Cerezo, Beltran are the riders setting the pace up there in the hope, and the other third pacemaker is Rubiera of Spain, and no vision of number one. The world champion must be feeling now that he has a chance, unloading his pockets here is Goraz Stengele, the Slovenian who's had his best season ever, and he's still in and has a reasonably fast sprint as well.
Well, the Swedish rider Niklas Axelsson is in this group, so too is Richard Virenque right in there as well. Still Jean-Cyril Robin is there, but the Spaniards, Phil, with Beltran on the front here, doing an absolutely magnificent job of setting up the sprint for their man Oscar Ferreira. Going through there is Sergio Barbaro. On his wheel is the other rider from the Mapei squad, that's Gianni Farazin. A lot further down is Michele Bartoli. It's setting itself up to be a magnificent sprint. Soon the Italians, I think, are going to take over the pacemaking at the front.
They've got to launch the attack that will decide this championship on this long drag now, because it's nearly over. And here comes the attack again.
Sergio Barbaro has gone off now. That is strange to see him attack like that, because I would have expected him to try and set up the sprint for the rest. And it's the Italians all over the front of the main field. They really need to shut it down right now. And if this man walks away with it, that will be a surprise victory.
It will be a surprise, but not a bad world champion in Sergio. His face is saying he won't keep away, though, but he might, as comes the counter-attack behind. I'm not sure why the Italians are chasing each other here.
I can't believe that was Michele Bartoli. He halved the gap, the advantage that Barbaro had there. Now is Michael Bogert going down the far side. He's got a Belgian on his wheel, and that looks as if it may well still be André Schmeel, but they're all queuing up there down the right-hand side.
Team captains sometimes cannot accept. They have to become lieutenants. Because there's no doubt there that he should have given Barbaro his chance. Barbaro's blown it now. He's dropped down. Michael Bogart is launching another attack here. Chris Pierce in second place. That looks like Oscar Freire has got himself up to third.
Absolutely, third place for Freire. But the white jersey there is Scott Sunderland, riding a magnificent finale of the World Championships. Michele Bartoli is in fifth position right now, and the sprint is certainly going to open up quite soon. The gaps are starting to appear at the back of the field, but it's still hard to say who's going to take out the win.
David Rebellin with the glasses on is also there as well now. Bogart gritting his teeth, but it looks as though he's losing ground. Scott Sunderland still looking very cool. as this looks like it's Chris Pearce here still setting the pace. Frere is waiting and waiting and waiting. He doesn't want to go yet.
He dare not. He's used up his team pulling back all of those attacks. The final attack from André Schmeel, who is still right in the middle there. Schmeel at the moment in around about fifth place. Looking over his shoulders, David Brylens. Francesco Casagrande now moving down the outside. We haven't seen him at all so far. He may well have hit them right, Phil. This is the move that's going to take him to the Italian World Championships.
The big gear man of the peloton. He's no doubt turning his 55 chain wheel on a hill as he goes clear. This now is the attack by Francesco Casagrande. But you know, Paul, that field is still reacting. They're all looking at one another, but the pace is still high. In fact, it was David Brylens at the front, and he's still at the front for Belgium.
Well, you know, if they keep looking at each other like this, he will have hit them at the right time. He's opening up a pretty smart advantage. It's not very much more than 5 or 6 seconds, exactly the same advantage that André Schmeel had just a few kilometres ago. Somebody now is going to have to organise the pace at the front, and it will have to be Spain, but they've got no more riders left.
This is maximum effort now for Francesco Casagrande, who lost the Giro d'Italia in the final time trial. He'll have to live with that one, but now he's trying to make amends with the World Championship. He's over the top of this little climb. He's got his highest gear going, but that field has not given up. I reckon we're looking at 20 to 25 riders here hunting down Casagrande.
Casagrande's got to do or die now. He's got to dig as deep as he can. His whole body, Phil, is going to be screaming right now as he tries to get himself right off the front. He daren't look over because he knows that that main field is a little bit further back down the road than he is, but soon they will start to organise themselves. This is how he went. In fact, there was a rider from Switzerland tried to get onto his wheel there, but he opened up the gap very smartly indeed. He timed it to perfection, and you know, now they must organise themselves if they're going to pull him back, but this may well be the super comeback that this man has been looking for.
Well, that was either Nicky Ebersold or Oscar Kamerzin, and perhaps if he had got onto the back wheel of Casagrande, then they might have flown straight away. But as it is, the reaction is coming now all of the time. This field is closing back down. That's Schmeel now trying to end it. Bogaerts looks over his shoulder at the same time, saying, "It's not me, I'm looking for somebody else."
Well, that acceleration by Schmeel has brought it back just that little bit closer. But every time they slow down like this, it will give the advantage to Francesco Casagrande. If they don't get him by the last kilometre, this man is going to fly to a World Championships. It is still, though, a huge group. Coming to the front of that group is Maximilian Schiandri. Schiandri should not be doing that right now. He should sit in the pack and wait for the chance to try and get the win.
Absolutely. Max is on his own, let's not forget. I think it's about 23 riders. I quickly counted from the helicopter there. As Casagrande trying to hang on, but the field has still time. It's a long straight run into the finish yet. We'll flick right again shortly. Casagrande, though, is a rider now who's going to have to be totally committed. There is no way now, if he gets caught, he'll win the world title. It's win alone or win nothing.
Oh, the pain, it really does hurt now. Every pedal stroke takes him slightly closer to that World Championship, the title. He's looking over his shoulder now. That's a sign of no confidence at all. He mustn't do that. He must completely concentrate. But you know what? They're right there. The work on the front is coming from Axel Merckx.
Yes, I think he just took that second look back and thought, that's it, it's not going to work. It's about time André Schmeel took another dig for the finish. He won't want to leave it to the sprint. And so Casagrande looked like a winning move, is now back into the fold, but the group is down to about 22 riders.
1 kilometre to go. Somebody else has nicked off the front there. I didn't get an ID on that rider, but there's another lone leader. It's not Francesco Casagrande anymore. And you know, they're going to have to react pretty smartly, because inside the last kilometre, that's a dangerous time to move.
It looks like it might be the colours of a Swiss rider. Oh no, it's not. It's a Belgian rider, Chris Pearce, isn't it?
Schmeel. Schmeel it is. Oh. Schmeel is gone. I don't believe it. David Rebellin is the Italian coming across trying to make contact. Schmeel came over the top of the work done there by Axel Merckx, and what a performance by this man. He's coming up to the finishing straight very smartly now. Rebellin is in second position, but they're really picking it up right behind him.
Well, this is such a typical finish to a single day race for André Schmeel. It is try and take it on the line. We've seen it so many times. He's made the move. The sprint is starting right behind him now. They swept up David Rebellin as they race up towards the line. Schmeel is not going to hang on. They're coming so quickly here. And that looks to me as though it's Roman Veenstainers on the line. Well, it was a surprise in the end after all of that. Veenstainers has got the victory from Latvia. We never talked about him throughout the whole of the championship, but he was always there. And the Poles will feel vindicated for the chase down, because Zbigniew Spruch on the right has finished in second place.
with the face on Sprook there. Second place, he's not happy with it. This is a remarkable performance here. For a moment there, I thought Shamil had got it there on the left-hand side, but what a magnificent lead out it was for Weinsteins. Weinsteins used Shamil right until the last moment. With about 50 metres to go, he flicked by him, and coming right up to the line, the throw of the bike for second place of Sprook. But what a man there, Roman Weinsteins, the revelation at Tirreno Adriatico, and what a surprise. We hardly saw him in the whole race, and he gets the win.
And Oscar Freire has defended his championship as best he could with a brilliant third place here. Now watch the rider in that maroonish coloured jersey, Roman Weinsteins, former military world road race champion, which is usually participated by the former Iron Curtain countries. Sprook coming in a late run, he gets second. Bartoli gets third, no, he's fourth. He'll be fourth behind Freire. And I think it was Toby Steinhauser who was right up there as well. There's the scrum, traditional at the end of a championship. But I don't know what language they'll speak to him in. I know he does speak Italian. And this is the first ever world championship for Latvia.
Absolutely remarkable. He timed that to perfection as we looked down through the gap there. A great move though by Andre Schmielfil. He really did fight right down to the last moment. He never gave up, and even inside the last 500 metres after that last lap attack, he went for it. But the day belongs to the man we're looking at right now, Roman Weinsteins. He's a great performer, and I think he's going to be a good world champion.
And this brings to an end a wonderful week of racing here, despite the weather conditions and despite the lack of some big names. Jeremy Bates, the new junior world champion, the first ever from New Zealand. Mari Holden, the time trial world champion for the United States. And for Great Britain, a junior world champion for the first time ever as well in Nico Cook. As we look here at the man enjoying a boxing match with an invisible competitor, Roman Weinsteins, the new world champion. And he's been so consistent, I don't think we'll be surprised at all if he gets more than 9 wins next year, which is the total so far for Oscar Freire. What do you think, Paul?
I think we'll see him win an awful lot more races. 11 wins last year. Weinsteins at the top of the leaderboard ahead of Zevgenij Sprook. Freire in third position. Michele Bartoli a little bit disappointed there in fourth place. And it was Tobias Steinhauser in fifth.
7th Scott Sunderland, he'd be delighted with that. He could have gone better though. And Chan McCrae in the top 5 last year, now makes 8th this time out. That's a good result for the American. He really is a great bike rider. Look at the crowd here witnessing a big bunch sprint in the end. A very unlucky Andre Schmil, who played every card he had in his hand and it didn't work out for him, and yet on any other occasion it probably would have. And so Latvia get their man across the line first, and that's a nation who really supports their heroes. And I think we've just found a new one here. So as Weinsteins looks over his shoulder and sees that the Polish team did their job well, because Sprook clearly had the form, getting second place, a good result for Poland as well, and a nice congratulations too from Zbigniew Sprook as he salutes the pit helpers on the right and indicates second place for me, and thanks guys for all the hard work you did to bring back that original breakaway of 9 which went so early on in the race. And that gentleman, oh dear me, well that's the way it goes when you want to get up and kiss your man. That will be very typical, and it'll be a lot of celebrations tonight in the Latvian camp. They'll all enjoy themselves. There he is, now called to the podium. He's quite emotional about this, but why shouldn't he be? We never saw him at the front of the bunch till it mattered most, and that was when he crossed the line.
Great ride though, Phil, there in third position by Oscar Freire. Very rarely does a world champion pop out of the bag and defend as well as he did today, and the whole of the Spanish team. But this man, we'll see an awful lot more of him next year, wearing the arc-en-ciel, the rainbow jersey on his back. And who knows which team he'll go to, because there is talk that he will go to the new big Belgian team, the Domo squad. And that, I think, win today will certainly put his price up just a little bit, and he really deserves to get emotional.
Absolutely. Tears of great happiness for Roman Weinsteins, as this wonderful supportive crowd at Blue see and receives from Monsieur Omini, Senior Vice President of the UCI. The rainbow jersey, can't believe this. He's looking down at the white jersey with the rainbow bands that every cyclist in the world wants to wear once. Freire, I think, is disappointed. He won it last year as a surprise. He came back in a sprint and finished third. Those tears are going to flow for a while yet, I think. And he's going to wear it, I think, with proudness when we come to the Tour of Lombardy shortly. And that in itself could see Schmil in the action again, this time taking on the challenge from the World Cup leader, Erik Zabel. There's a silver medal for Zbigniew Spruch, into his mid-30s now and riding better than ever.
Magnificent ride by him. A little disappointed to get second place, but two, the Polish squad rode magnificently to put him in a situation which got him very close to the world title. Oscar Ferreira, well, he's been a great world champion over the last 12 months. A bronze medal for him, Phil. And he's too a rider, if he can get his health problems sorted out, that we'll see an awful lot of next year.
I agree indeed, Paul. And there's no surprise with these three names in this championship. They all deserve their place on the podium. It'll dawn on him a bit later when he wakes up and still sees the yellow jersey in his bedroom. The yellow jersey, listen to me, the World Championship jersey. He's been a most consistent single-day bike rider, and in fact, by my calculation, he'll now be in the top three in the world rankings after that victory. So as we look down and listen to the anthem from Latvia, we'll say goodbye from Plouay after a great week of racing. And don't forget, next up, it'll be the Tour of Lombardy, another head-to-head battle. Until then, for Paul Sherwin, I'm Phil Liggett saying goodbye.